tomorrow. You'll understand. Then we'll go walking hand in hand. And then in the evening, by the moonlight, I'll hold you, darling.
Me on the stage, and now I went up to him and he flung his arms around me.
Don't worry about me.
It was special to me because I felt he was saying, "It's all right, Mama."
Billy Fury was only 42 when he died a month later on January the 28th, 1983. I remember, like a lot of other fans, I was very cut up about it. And I cried.
Well, you're gonna make me so. You a fool, I ain't a fool, no more.
He had a brilliant voice. He had a voice that had something in it. But he had breath in it, and he had a little bit of natural, not a vibrato exactly, but a natural thing. It wasn't forced. But I think he had the most, I don't know, plaintive is a word you might. He had a great voice.
Honey, you'll do more than anything, but don't knock upon my door.
I think Billy Fury is Britain's best ever rock and roll singer. He wrote many of his own songs. He had 29 hit records, and he was only outsold in the 60s by Elvis, Cliff and the Beatles.
I think they may, you leave me halfway to paradise. So near, yet so far.
I've always rated Billy Fury as a singer and a very handsome geezer, brilliant haircut, always had those really dodgy, grey, shiny, nicely cut and Soho looking suits.
I think, you know, if people think of British rock and roll, they tend to think of him straight away. Just the sort of gold lamé suit and the quiff and sort of moodiness, and it's just like a classic image. I don't think it'll ever be unpopular.
Billy's fans from around the world have commissioned a statue to be made by Liverpool artist Tom Murphy, which they hope will be placed on the Liverpool waterfront, not far from his home in Dingle, where he was born on April the 17th, 1940.
I was born around the area, in the district, myself. And I went to the same school as where Billy went to. And I thought that the area was fantastic. It was a good area. It was a terraced house, but there was it wasn't two up and two round. There was a parlour kitchen and back kitchen. And the upstairs was three bedrooms.
The war had only just finished. The country was still trying to get back on its feet. Rationing was still around. Jobs were mainly in the shipping industry in Liverpool, in warehousing, on the docks.
My dad had his own shop, you see, and I think with him having his own shop, maybe he had a bit more money than what some of the other people had, you know. So he could afford to spend a bit more money on the house. Very similar to these type of houses that are here now. It was nice and smart and clean and tidy. Nice black and white tile step. The only one in the street, you know. That probably was a bit posh for around there, you know, at the time.
Good evening, friends. Their name is Horace Batchelor.
They were cobble streets. It was called the Holy Land because of Isaac Street, Jacob Street, David Street, and they were all along there. So everybody used to say, oh, yes, he lives up in the Holy Land, which is where Billy was born.
He was quite a healthy baby when he was born. I mean, he was just under 7 pounds. It was only when he was six he got his first attack of rheumatic fever. And then, of course, he was in all the hay for about 2 months, something like that, and he had to just lay flat. And then, of course, the following year, he had a recurrence of it.
He had a recurrence later on when he was about 12, I think, which left him with a damaged valve in the heart, you know.
I was always sick. I was always in hospital. And doctors, or I was lying in bed somewhere. And I missed a hell of a lot of my schooling. And every time I got back to school, I didn't know the kids. I was a kind of, always the stranger.
I believe for every drop of rain that falls, a flower...
I remember us going in that church. You see that church over there?
I believe that somewhere in the dark...
That's a Catholic church, now. And we were Protestants, and we went to the Catholic church because our mates were all Catholics.
And of course, the neighbour down the road said, "Oh," she said, "I couldn't believe it when I saw your Ronnie and your Albert walking around, you know, the Catholic church with my boys, you know."
Hence, one of the calls from his father on the door to say, "You're not converting my son to Catholicism."
We were banned from speaking to him, you know.
But you went in their house. You weren't welcome.
Maybe it was to do with the way his mum was protecting him. But we'd be going to the park to play football or wherever, down to town to do a bit of shoplifting or whatever.
Shoplifting, listen.
Yeah. I mean, you know.
Which we all done.
And he'd sort of say, "We'll go in the park," and he'd follow us later on.
I think we tried to give the boys, you know, what we could. I mean, I think they did get a little bit more than a lot of others did. Billy went to piano lessons when he was about 11 because he was so much interested in music. And then he said, "I'm going to get a guitar." He was self-taught. He used to sit for hours and hours and do the chords. And the noise used to make out of that guitar sometimes, his dad used to go mad, you know, and he'd hear it.
Don't say so. Don't say so.
He made out I made a terrible racket, which I did. And only learned to play, I think it was, I had three chords, so I couldn't play the songs I wanted to play. So I decided to, I didn't decide, I kind of made up my own songs.
So I'd go to the parlour, as we call them, the front room in the house, you know, the special guest room thing. And we'd sit in there, and so I'd slot in the chord that would help him to progress with the song.
I'm getting lost, darling, won't you please?
Always been music in the family. Hank Williams, some of the early Elvis Presley stuff, Frankie Lane.
And this fella called Nappy Brown, I'd never heard of him. And he said to me, "Would I go and get this record for him?" At a shop, big record shop in Park Road. And I said, "Oh, no, I'm not going in to ask for that." And he said, "Well, you know, I want it." He got a job on the tugs. He always said he wanted to be a sailor, go away to sea.
But he always pulled his eyes and he don't care.
They just got a couple of lads together. One had a tea chest, that was the bass. The other fella had the snare drum, and then Billy had his guitar. Hence the Formby Sniffle Group.
He'd found a seagull injured, and he'd carried it the full length of the promenade to the RSPCA. And of course, his suit was soaking wet, and he was back in hospital again, rheumatic fever. Then they told me then that Billy was. He'd have to get the tugs up, but always said, let him lead a normal life.
When we become sort of 14 or 15, he got an interest in two things, birds of the flying kind and birds of the two-breasted, two-legged kind.
5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock.
And then, of course, the music scene began to change as well.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is Radio Luxembourg, your station of the stars.
Oh, it's Saturday. Yes, it's Saturday.
And hello there, record fans, wherever you are. Once again, it's time for another roundup of all your favourite British and American recording artists.
Just my baby left me.
Now, this is Park Road, where if you were anybody, you'd strut your stuff down here. You know, you'd have your teddy boy gear on, or... You'd have your drape jackets on, you'd go waltzing off down this road down here.
Never said a word.
Have you heard the chaps who were involved in this trouble with the church club last week?
Oh, yes, yes.
Were you in the fight?
Oh, no, we weren't in the fight, then. No.
You didn't hit the vicar?
No.
No.
Because his dad used to go mad, you know, and when we were having the shop, people used to go and say, oh, Teddy boys, this and your, you know, and being in business, you know what it was like.
Well, I had a lot of trouble in the beginning, wearing tight trousers and long jackets, velvet collars, because of my dear father.
I'm not having my son walking around like a bloody teddy boy.
Well, it was a clip over the ear, so what I used to do was...
I had his teddy boy trousers and the toilet in the yard.
Go out my baggy trousers. I used to dash up the entry, climb over the wall, into the toilet, change into my tight trousers, etc. And then I was sort of out on the town for the night. My baby.
To work for Joshua Harris, the wholesalers in Liverpool. Of course, that was a good environment for him because it had lots of women.
I was about 14, working there on a Saturday, and that's when I first met Ronnie. And all the girls were just absolutely head over heels. You know, I mean, he was absolutely gorgeous. Jealousy. And they used to every now and again arrange trips, and one was to Blackpool. I ended up on the back seat with him coming out. I couldn't believe my luck, really, that night. He used to have an old guitar. He carried it all around the shop with him. Whenever he had a break, he'd be in there strumming. I actually saw him write that song to Margot. I remember asking him what I'm writing a song to Margot.
I'm pretty sure Margot was actually a married woman. A bit older than him too, you know. That was him, though.
And there was either one he was going out with, one he was trying to go out with, or one who was trying to go out with him.
Well, he was a sexy sod, wasn't he? You know, he just oozed it. If he went to any parties, he'd only have to walk into the room and you'd sort of see blobs of oil on the couch where women used to be. They just used to melt. Of course, their boyfriends used to love this after several pints. And so we were always getting threatened, you know.
He went to one of these booths and made this. We sent a tape off. We heard that Larry Parnes was coming to the Zeldo.
I can remember quite distinctly him bringing down an advert, which was from the Larry Parnes Emporium, looking for talent. Send me a tape. Oh no, you don't stand
no kissing, my baby. Had Billy on the stairs with the guitar, and we had the drummer upstairs to get the backing. We had Billy Fiore in the toilet singing.
Well, then a letter came from Larry Parnes to say this big extravaganza show was at the Zeldo, and if he cared to come there, he'd see him.
He looked as though he was an artist, with his guitar over his arm, in a pillowcase, walking towards his soul, though. He was greeted by girls who immediately began touching him, asking who he was. Are you on stage tonight? I said, yeah, baby. I can remember Mr. Parnes saying to him, hi, and he showed him the letter, and he said, oh, right, I remember you. He said, are these your backing group? We said, no. He said, just friends. He said, well, you guys go away, is go and get a seat in the auditorium, and we'll see you later.
And he came in. I remember him being as he always was, really, and as I knew him to the end. He was shy. He wasn't a pushy kind of guy, laid back, but shy most of all. And he played these songs.
Larry Parnes said, if I say to you, you're going on stage in 8 minutes, will you say yeah? And I really felt like saying no, but for some reason I thought I ought to say yeah.
I really was suffering from very bad nerves, and I decided at the last moment not to go through the curtains. Well, I was pushed through the curtains eventually, and suddenly I was in this great big light with the microphone standing in front of me. And as I started to sing, I was so nervous that my knees were shaking.
He just looked the part. He then sang Maybe Tomorrow, which he'd already penned by that time. Could hear a pin drop. He sang an old Elvis number called Just Because, which was one he could shake his leg about. So hard to stay in town, just because you think you got finished, the applause was the start of his career.
And he said to me, Mum and Dad, I can join this tour, that's what I want. So the next morning, it's funny getting the bus down into town with a guitar and a pillowcase, you know, because he didn't have a guitar case. When the war was on, you know, he sent all the kids away, didn't he? And he all had these little brown cases, you know, that's what his case was like. Little brown case and a pillowcase with a guitar in it. It's funny.
My baby left me, my baby left me. I said my baby left me. She never said a word, now not one word.
I said, now, listen, you tell Larry Palms he hasn't got to wake you to death. You've got to ring us every night and let's know what's happening.
Do you rechristen all your boys?
Oh, yes, I think this is terribly important. Otherwise, they would go on the stage with peculiar names. It wouldn't be part of their makeup.
Their names are a bit peculiar as it is, aren't they? Pride, Gentle, Fury, Eager. Why do you choose names like that?
Well, this means something, you see. For example, with Fury, Billy is nice and friendly, and Fury is a little bit ferocious, so gives him the mean streak.
And he said, oh, I've got an uncle named Billy, which he has. I mean, he had twin brothers. One was Ronnie and one was Billy, and he was called after one of them. So he took the other boy's name, Billy, and that's where Billy Fury came in. And he liked it.
Father, don't go.
The first time I saw Billy was standing with Larry Palmer in The Two Eyes. That's where rock and roll started in this country. He was all in awe of it all. And then I said, where are you staying? And he said, well, I'm staying with Larry Palmer. So I suggested he didn't, because he'd get himself a bad name. I like. He said, well, I only just moved here. So I said, well, okay. I said, you can stay at my place. And he gave me a funny look then, with my girlfriend, I said. I think his looks got him the interview.
It was a fantastic gig because Larry Powers had the monopoly on rock and roll touring in those days. I can remember playing in Liverpool and bringing the house down, and the Beatles were in the audience. But don't be
nobody. We toured together on a big bus and everything. They were quite friendly then, but the moment the Sparkly Jackets went on and the Barnet was done, they changed.
And there'd be about six or seven different artists on the bill. And they literally used to have fist fights over who was going to sing Hound Dog.
Well, I was terrified of him getting hurt.
When Eddie Cochran was killed in the car accident, I got to London, heard the news, and went straight back to Bath. I didn't see him, but I hung about for news, and he died at 10 o'clock in the morning. It was the loss of a very, very good friend. Really feel.
They were hysterical, the fans of those days. They used to tear bits off him, you know. He came out this door and he was dressed to go home, you know, the Lorex was off. And a load of girls ran around the corner. They had hold of each sleeve and pulled. He was just standing there like that, crucified.
And I mean, I'd climb over a roof before I'd go through a stage door with a crowd of people. And then we'd climb out of windows and run along walls and get into, you know, I'd have the car around the back of somewhere.
The girlfriends would drag this big hairy bloke along, you know, covered in tattoos, you know, and a bit of quiff, and sit down in the front row and spend time freaking out about Billy Fury.
Billy was in the middle of one of his kind of pseudo-Elvis moves. Stage left, shimmy of the hips, bump, and an empty bottle of whiskey came down from the gods.
It's great when you're young, you can put up with anything.
Don't you ever feel that you are being manipulated just like a puppet sometimes?
There's no way to do it right.
No, I think it's up to you to go outside and the performance you do, it's all your own, you know? All your own work, what you do on the stage.
Well, he was 17 and I was 21. I was like a big brother to him at that time.
We would have all liked the bit of special treatment that Pals gave Billy, because we're all youngsters, are all trying to make our way. But Billy was the one he was putting all his attention to. In any family, there's the favourite, and Billy was the favourite.
It was grooming, it was being fashioned, it was being, you know, almost like you were a Chippendale, but not, that's not a good analogy.
Jack Good was an influence on everyone. I mean, he is definitely the guru of British rock and roll.
Larry said, "Jack, who's he look like? Who's he look like? Go on, who's he look like, eh? Eh? Who's he look like?" And I was embarrassed for the chap sitting there, and I refused to say he looked like Elvis, because he didn't. Don't wait about for me. I immediately took a shine to him because he was so genuine, so shy. He was a real guy, you know, not a fake performer at all.
I remember him walking onto the set, yes. He was a very quiet guy. Oh, shy. He was shy. But these drop-dead gorgeous looks. So, of course, he was a magnet. The girls went... He was a magnet, and he was so sweet.
When Billy went on stage, he used to adopt this... Like an actor, you know, he used to go out and do that thing. He wasn't like that off stage at all. It was like a part.
My attitude was that of a director for an actor. I wanted something more than just wiggling about. I wanted flash and danger. That was my big thing. You've got to look dangerous. You've got to feel you might break out of the whole thing, smash the cameras and walk out of the studio.
It was Jack that was creating this image. Shy.
Moody.
Moody. A very moody sort of thing. And he was saying, "Now move, Billy, I'm doing the crutch shots." And he was down underneath, honestly, literally, with the camera going, "I want another crutch shot here, another crutch shot there." And we thought this was hilarious.
And what he did, he wrapped the handkerchief round to make it look bigger.
No, I think it was a cucumber, actually.
And then Jack did all these incredible close-ups of him, and there was murders.
Billy was a great artist, and I've got to tell you, I was a musician, I was in the band, and I didn't see, I honestly couldn't see what all these kids were screaming about. Everything's right when she
holds me tight. And he'd often whiz past me, and I'd hear this sort of volley of abuse come from him. The first time I thought he was swearing at me. You know, effing and blinding, and really, you know, a bit strong. And, through working with him a lot, he used to do this every night, and it was a way of making himself this aggression, and it came up over the footlights.
I turned up late for a show, couldn't get in the stage door, so I had to go in through the front, and it's the first time I'd ever seen him from the front. Fantastic performer, absolutely electric atmosphere, and for the first time, and I'd known him for years, I thought, this is what it's about. This guy is really good.
I stood behind him many times, and he used to punch his shoulders. The tabs would be closed and be waiting to go on. It'd be a bag of nerves, no confidence at all. And then the comedian would be out the front and they'd announce, "Ladies and gentlemen, God, you've all been waiting for Billy Fury." As they said his name, he took a deep breath and he stood up, and it was amazing. He seemed to grow about 4 inches. And Ronnie Wycherley turned into Billy Fury.
And then he'd walk off stage and we said, "Oh, great show, girls, you know." And he'd say,
Oh, yes, thanks, Sheila.
Well, it was all right.
Yes, okay. Shall we go and have a nice cup of tea now? You know, it was that sort of thing.
He'd come over and say, was it all right? It was as if he couldn't accept why they liked him. He couldn't understand it.
The Beatles auditioned to be his backing group because he was looking for a group then. And he said, I don't want to know. He said, they are trouble. They are. And I think he was right. I mean, it would be Lennon. Lennon would not have been an easy man to even have in your backing group, would he?
And John Lennon told me that he really liked Billy Fury. And he said the best rock singer came from Liverpool in this country anyway. And, of course, Billy was younger than any of the Beatles.
Liverpool wasn't a big city. London was. So he started a dreamer for all of us, really.
The sound of Fury has become quite a classic, you know, amongst the old Teddy Boys and that, and real rock fans. They love that album, small 10-inch album.
And a lot of artists start by singing other people's songs and then want to get into doing their own songs. And that happens with a lot of bands, or did. I think now everybody has got to write their own songs pretty what. But Billy was a pioneer, a singer-songwriter. I mean, Elvis didn't write songs. Billy wrote those songs, those early songs. You know, it was very, very unusual.
And he'd say, I've just written this. And he'd play something and quietly, the whole man was before you. I just felt that this had to be recorded simply, you know, one day. I bullied Decca into letting us at least cut these numbers. Their confidence in us was, I suppose, shown by the fact that we had a budget for 5 musicians, that Billy had to fly in his own vocal backing group, and that we were given 2 3-hour sessions to make 10 songs. Well, I come along and down and I come to you, making up with someone I knew, who I thought you was my baby, and then I took her to love and the truth. I then come along and find and make love with someone new. So the soul of Billy Fury really is in that record, and I'm very proud of that, and I think Billy was very proud of that.
Sound of Fury. It's an incredible record for several reasons. I mean, it was all self-written for a start, and I mean, nobody did that then. Nobody did it for a few years after. Even the Beatles didn't do it until, like, third or fourth album or something. And it's just an amazing achievement to actually get something that sounds that authentic. And for a British record from that period, it's completely unique.
But then somehow, somewhere along the line in his career, he stopped doing that. They started covering other people's songs, like Halfway to Paradise. I want to. The original version that Billy copied was a Tony Orlando song, and incredibly successful, you know, so it's a shame, really, because I thought he was a really great songwriter and could have built on that. I'm only halfway
to. I can remember being in the studio in Decca in West Hampstead when he recorded Halfway to Paradise, because I was in his band, but I wasn't capable of playing that thing in E-flat and doing that actual session. You know, it was a full orchestra in there, but I was sitting at the back in the studio while he recorded it, and he did it live with a huge orchestra and just put it down, and it was a wonderful hit.
Didn't think it was going to be a big hit, did he? I mean, it was like he preferred to do his own songs. Well, over my jealousy, my crime was my Parnes didn't seem to know what to do. All he was doing was sending us out touring. My heart was afire with desire for you. This night of
Well, I mean, it was a bit of a joke between he and I about it, you know, because it was sort of saying, well, we've got to sing these syrupy songs. I said, yeah, but they've become hits, haven't they? He said, yeah, but, you know. And it was a sort of a down-up because he wanted to get out and do his thing, and I did exactly the same.
Maybe tomorrow,
and there was Halfway to Paradise. They were the great ballads in his repertoire. The other stuff was like Etta James. Billy was into Etta James.
He felt things so deeply, which is unusual for very, very young people.
Yes, most definitely.
And he would sing from the heart.
I know I never want to leave you, 'cause if I search my whole life through, I know there'd only be a second best for me. I'd never find another you.
Go into the depths of despair, and someone would want to talk to you about it. And sort
he
of
did,
say,
he really
did. What did I do wrong, and where does it, and why, and will I never find anybody of my own? There was also a very downside. I can remember him actually drawing. I'm sure other people must have told you about this. He had this fixation about graveyards and graves.
He would say things like, you know, I won't live to an old age, you know, I'm just gonna... But people have been saying that, you know, for years, like James Dean.
It was hip to say you weren't gonna live very long, doing a moody, we used to call it. And we used to think Billy was doing this.
I don't wanna be the one to say I'm gonna miss you, but I will.
He could be very serious and a bit dramatic, you know. And he set me down and said, Lee, I think before I ask you what I'm going to ask you, that you ought to know about my health. And he told me that he wouldn't live long, which, of course, you don't take that in.
And just remember when you got...
I didn't realise the extent of it till we got engaged, but he was always very ill.
Play it cool, baby.
I'd never made a proper feature film. I'd made a nudist documentary, which grossed a fortune.
We get this director, Mr. Michael Winner, whose only claim to fame was a nudist bloody film he'd done, with all these dodgy people all dashing about with beach balls in front of them, and you know what I mean, and their bum to the camera and whatnot.
And I was asked to direct Billy Fury at Pinewood Studios, which was my first break into feature motion pictures.
I had a dream I met her long ago, but somehow I can't forget her. I met her once upon a dream. We built a castle where we planned to live. Precious moments in the land of never. I met her once upon a dream.
The man who booked the film to Associated British saw Play It Cool and said, this is the biggest load of old rubbish I've ever seen. Billy Fury is revolting. And we ain't going to show this film on our cinema screens. And he said, well, let's try it out in three theatres. Well, the cinema was packed. You couldn't get in. There were kids in the lobby. There were kids in the street who couldn't get in. They cheered, they shouted. They quite obviously adored it.
He enjoyed the singing. He enjoyed writing, making records, and doing television, and doing the shows. But what he didn't enjoy was all that razzmatazz with it.
Because of love, I'm 100 feet tall.
was a very difficult man to do business with. And Billy wasn't into business really at all.
Pals loved him like a son.
He fought very heavily with Larry. I mean, I've been witness to some humdinging fights. When I get tired and feeling blue. Larry pushed him into a pantomime and he backed out of that.
Hans never did anything to hurt him. Not that he could, because Bill would do it.
He backed out of the Palladium, which was a very bad thing.
If he felt it was too much or he didn't want to do it, he wouldn't do it. My one and only
prayer is that someday you'll care. Billy was having hit records and Billy was doing quite well. So I think out of the whole bunch, yeah, on those package things, I would say that Billy was probably the one person that was still enjoying those shows as opposed to us, you know, because I'd come over from this early, you know, the early rock thing which I was doing. And when the groups come in, a lot of it changed for us.
By the mid-60s, the Beatles and the group sound took over the charts, pushing Billy towards variety and showbiz. He even starred with his racehorse in another film, I Got a Horse. Riding high, if
you see what I mean. 100-1 and Selmo bought the week before by pop singer Billy Fury for 8.5 pounds.
He remained in the charts with a series of torrid emotional ballads which reflected the way his personal life seemed to be going. If I've made you unhappy, I'm sorry for what I've done wrong. You can't really mean it's all over. Give me a chance.
Get to a stage when we lived out in the country where his whole life went to bird watching and bird photographing. That's what he wanted to do. He wanted to become a photographer of birds in the end. He didn't want to be a rock and roller in the end. He wasn't excessive in anything really.
A lot of people at the time, knowing that he had a bad heart, were surprised that he used to smoke, but that was his way of relaxing, to have a joint, whether it was on a session or wherever it was, just relaxing at home. But he had to watch things a bit because he'd always had a bit of a heart problem. He used to hope it'd go away, I think.
I didn't feel ill until I was about 26 or something like that, around about 25, 26, before all this rheumatic fever, etc., really affected my heart to a point where I could feel physically that something was wrong. I felt exhausted and I had a bit of trouble breathing.
He did need looking after, and yeah. I think, again, that was probably part of his attraction to women. This diamond ring
doesn't shine. I'd had an affair with someone and he found out about it and decided the best way to get his own back was to go off with my best friend. He had to get his own back on things. He was a revenge taker. Talking about a hard time.
Hard time. The tours and the life of a pop star took their toll. Always frail with his heart trouble, he collapsed and went into hospital for 2 heart operations.
They actually just repaired the valve and said, okay, Billy, you're fine now. So I got myself together and did a bit of nightclub work.
He was playing in a pub, big pub.
Each night I count the stars in the skies.
He said, in the old days, I felt like I was on a carousel. It was marvellous. You know, when you're a kid and you're on it and you don't want it to stop. Life was like that. He said, but now, he said, I'm still in the carousel. And he said, and I want to get off, but no one's stopping it. He said, I've had it now.
She got very violent, you know, the ex-wife, when he moved out. Keith Moon took him round to collect his things with a shotgun. Stoned out of his little blessed bean.
And suddenly, the whole thing came back again. I just couldn't believe it. Then I had to have the valve actually replaced, you know.
With his health and women giving him grief, he said goodbye to all the crap and became a pop star recluse, retiring to a Welsh hill farm with his animals and birds. He was to stay away for nearly 8 years. All my dreams have... I met Billy. I just went up and said hello to him at this reception. And he was talking to me. He was confiding in a few things like this, that and the other. And he told me he'd got a dodgy Orson cart. And he said, well, the thing, he said, what you want to do? He said to me, what you want to do is get a farm and get out in the field and dig a few holes, he said. That'll do, you know, get all the stress and strain of being a pop star out of the way. And I got to know him, and he was such a down-to-earth geezer, and very sweet. And that's the only time I met him. And I was, you know, I was like a little groupie. It was great. I was really impressed.
I did quit out and sort of retired to a farm in Wales where I was running a flock of 300 sheep. And I breed horses, and I take care of injured wild creatures, mostly birds. I work physically on the farm with the animals, but I'm able to pace myself. You know, I don't go out there and go crazy for 8 hours.
Tony Reid kept saying to me, "Oh, he's dying. You know, he's dying down there. He's like a cabbage. He's just fading away."
Walking along the farm one day, said, fancy a little go before you get too old? And he said, yes. I want to
be your love. A friend of mine who I've known for over 20 years asked me if I would make a record called Be Mine Tonight. Why can't I say tonight? I was a little bit terrified when it came to coming up to London and going in studios. I thought, oh gosh, I haven't sung for about something like 10 years. Even though it's been
so long. And he liked the records. I mean, I was down in London when Be Mine Tonight came out, also, especially Devil or Angel, because that was doing very well. You look like an angel.
Tours and everything are definitely out, and live shows are definitely out as well. I found the anxieties of the whole thing quite too much for me, so, you know, this is really nothing like a comeback. Love me or leave me, I've made up my mind. Devil or angel, dear, whichever you are, I love you, I want you. I love you. You look like an angel. Your smile is so divine. But you keep me guessing. Will you ever be mine? Devil or angel, please say that you'll be mine. Love me or leave me, I'll go out of my mind.
The truth of the matter is that he wanted to earn his living again, because he hadn't actually worked, you see, he hadn't worked for so long, and he wanted to make his own money because he felt trapped.
I used to put my hand on his heart after he'd come off stage. Yes, it used to be racing, and before we left the building it used to be normal, but then I've seen other people in the same situation. But he never said that he was in any pain. He never said that he felt ill. He was chuffed to bits to be up there.
He came on This Is Your Life, they did My Life, and I nearly fell through the floor when he came backstage. I could hardly believe it. Very thin. I had my arms around him at this show, you know. I knew how thin he was. It was just very, very bony. There was something terribly wrong.
He liked what he heard, and he pulled quite a surprise on me, didn't
he? Yeah, he sure did, because he brought the promoter of the rock and roll show along to hear those couple of songs, and within 8 minutes I was on the stage myself.
That's true. That's true.
And from then on, we went on touring together, mm-hmm. And you were my first big break.
Thank you, Billy Curry.
He was like brittle bones, just bones, you know, so very, very skinny. I found that quite frightening. It was very, very frightening. And he was very down, very sad. And it was more pronounced than I'd ever seen it before.
He was running out of time. And I'm almost sure he knew as well. There'll be no sorrow.
Maybe tomorrow. Maybe tomorrow. Maybe tomorrow.
I think he's a great singer. I mean, he's in a class of his own, but he's in a similar, you could say he's in a similar bag to Elvis Presley.
So although he was my brother, he's my idol as well, you say. I was a fan of Billy Fury.
But they're just great songs sung in a very smouldering manner.
I think he's like one of the sort of, you know, prime influences of British pop, if not the prime influence. He predates Joe Meek, and you can hear his vocal sound in like David Bowie, and Morrissey was a big fan.
Peter Blake did a painting of me for the Sunday Times, surrounded with all my favourite singers, and Billy's in there next to me. Well, it's a good place to be, really. I long for you. Kiss my lips, but just